morning. Y'all are all so quiet. Pastor said, all right, Sister Sherry, go on, because everybody's so quiet. It's not time to be quiet. It is Easter Sunday morning, and we are here to celebrate our risen Savior. You know, today, go ahead, clap. Give him a hand clap. You know, today, we're able to walk into church, and we're able to sing songs like He Lives, and we're able to say things like our God is alive. You know, there are other religions that serve gods that they can go to their tomb, and guess what? He's still there. But our God's not still there, because our God has risen. Jesus went to that cross. We had an opportunity Friday to go to CCA and talk to the kids there and minister with Kenny. And I told those kids that we were talking about it's Good Friday, and that's so confusing to say it's Good Friday when you're talking about the day that our Savior was crucified. But it's Good Friday because He went to that cross, and He got up on that cross, and He allowed His hands and His feet to be nailed to that cross because He was doing it for you. Because He saw the future, and He was doing it for you. Yes. And that's the reason we celebrate that Good Friday.
Amen.
It was a Good Friday.
Yes,
because
amen.
It didn't look good to the people that were standing there seeing it happen, because they didn't know what the future held. All they could see was the circumstances of that moment. And you know, that's like us. Sometimes all we can see is the circumstances of our moment. But Jesus saw the future. He knew what He was about to do.
Yes.
And He did it willingly for me and for you. But on that Sunday morning, and that's what we told those kids at CCA, on that Sunday morning, early that Sunday morning, that stone was rolled away and our Savior was risen. He is risen today. We are able to come and celebrate a risen Savior today. And I'm so excited to be able to be here with you this morning and just to worship our King of Kings and our Lord of Lords.
Amen.
We're going to sing some songs and we're going to get into our praise and worship this morning. Our pastor is going to bring us an awesome word, and we're just here to worship Him this morning. So I'm going to ask you to stand. If you got a bulletin this morning, all the announcements are in there. But we're going to worship this morning because that's what we're here for. And let's just go to the Lord in prayer. We thank You, Lord, for being able to be here in Your house this morning. Lord, we thank You that You sent Your Son all those years ago, Lord, and that He was willing to die on that cross for our sins, Lord Jesus. Lord, we can stand here this morning and we can lift our hands and we can worship You this morning, Lord. Lord, I thank You for loving us. I thank You, Lord Jesus, that in my darkest time, Lord, You saw it. You saw all those years ago who I was going to be and what I was going to go through. And Lord, You were willing to lay down Your life for me. Lord, we worship You this morning. I thank You for each person that You have brought into this place this morning. Lord, I just pray over this service this morning, Lord Jesus, that You would bless our musicians, that You would bless our singers, Lord Jesus. Lord, anoint our pastor this morning, Lord, as he brings the word this morning, Lord Jesus. And Lord, if there's a heart, if there's a soul that has walked into this place today, Lord, that does not know You as their Savior, Lord, there's no better time than today, Lord Jesus, to give their life to You, Lord Jesus. Lord, have Your way in this service this morning. Lord, we love You, we praise You, we honor You, we thank You, Lord Jesus. In Your precious name we pray. Amen.
Jesus.
Today is a celebration. I don't know about you, but actually it's more than a celebration. We serve a God who went through the cross, died on the cross, took beatings and spitting and humiliation, got on the cross so we could experience life, so we could have the resurrection living inside of us. It's not just about Easter Sunday. It's not just about sitting here and seeing all the celebration. We have to understand that the celebration lives inside of us, that we have the resurrection in us. Today is more. I believe that today God deserves more than just a celebration. I believe He deserves everything that we've got today. I believe that He deserves our praise. He deserves our worship. He deserves more than a celebration today, because He took stuff that we couldn't take. And I thank God that I serve a God that's alive and well. I thank God that I serve a Lord who came to this earth so I could be free, so all my sins could be washed away. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross for me. Amen. Will you give Him another hand clap of praise? Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. I want our ushers to come on up to the front. We're going to worship the Lord. We're going to keep worshiping Him. We're going to worship Him in our tithes and our offering and our giving. Oh, that may sound crazy to you. It's not worship when I have to give away my money. Well, let me tell you, it's worship because God gave you the money that you can give away. Amen? And the money that you give away, is he's the biggest bank there ever was. What you give, he can return back to you. So I serve a God that when you give it, he returns it. And I love my Jesus. He don't ever let you go for wanting. He don't ever let you go for need. I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging for bread. Yes. I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging for bread. Amen. Brother Richard, will you say the blessing, please, sir?
Thank you. hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah.
A hand clap of praise, will you? Oh, come on, give him some praise, will you? Give him a shout of glory, Jesus. Lord, have your way, Jesus. Oh, Father, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Yes, amen. Will you turn to your neighbor and say, he is alive? Yes, amen. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm excited this morning. God is alive. Can you imagine running to the tomb on that brisk Sunday morning, seeing the stone rolled away, knowing that Jesus had died on the cross, that you witnessed his death, that you witnessed him being taken off, and then you run to the tomb expecting to go and prepare the body for death and put the fragrances on him. And you run to the tomb and you notice the stone had been rolled away. And you think, what in the world could have happened? Because in our carnal minds, it's hard for us to imagine, you know, that somebody would have actually rose from the dead. It's hard for us to think and to fathom about how that a mortal body could have come back to life and could have rolled the stone away after everything that he had been through. Let me tell you, it wasn't just a miracle that he rolled the stone away. He had been beaten. He had been almost his skin ripped off of his body. The crown on his head, his hands had been nailed. I mean, he didn't have, as a mortal body, as a body of a human, there wasn't much strength. I mean, even as a Hercules trying to remove a stone from a grave, but here this man had been, God, it could have been nothing but God that could have rolled this stone away and was gone. He wasn't even there, not even a hint of him being there. Man, it's awesome to just think that Jesus, and then for him to show up behind you and say, hey, who you looking for? You looking in the wrong direction. That's death over there. Here, turn to me, I'm life. Life everlasting. Man, what an amazing day it must have been. I can imagine, like Sister Sherry said, we're the only religion that can celebrate the God that is still alive. Yeah. Do y'all know Buddha's still in the ground? Yeah. He ain't gone nowhere. And Muhammad, he's still there. You can go dig him up. He's still there. Bones, he's still in the ground. He ain't come back yet. I don't think he's coming back, but Hey, I know my God. You can't find his bones, his flesh. It's all gone. He's risen from the dead. They've tried to prove that he's still there, but they ain't been able to prove it yet. So in 2,000-something years, I'm going to go ahead and keep believing that my God's sitting next to Jesus. My Jesus is sitting next to God up in heaven on the right hand, and he's taking intercession for me. That's the God that I serve. I got one scripture to read you this morning, and it's Romans 8 and 11. And I'm going to be reading out of a New Living Translation, so bear with me for those of you that are reading out of King James or New King James. I'm going to read a little bit different from this morning, and you'll just have to forgive me later. Amen? In Romans 8, 11, it says, "And the Spirit of God, who raised Jesus from the dead, lives in you." And just as God raised Jesus from the dead, he will give life to your mortal bodies by the same Spirit that is living within you. Father, I thank you, Jesus. Lord, I thank you for this wonderful day. God, I thank you for these great people who have come into your presence. Father, I thank you for rising from the dead. Father, I know that God, through this word, that Father, somebody's life this morning will be changed. And God, I give you praise. God, I give you glory. Father, we're not just here to sit through a sermon. Father, we're here to celebrate your resurrection. We're here to celebrate everything that you did for us. And God, I praise you, Father. Lord, on this Easter morning, I give you praise and I give you glory in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Shake somebody's hand and tell them he lives in you. Amen. Hallelujah. Y'all so pretty this morning. Y'all all look good. You're so welcome. Jason, stand up. Turn around. We twinning. That's my twin over there. My little twin, that's future preacher right there. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Isn't it awesome? He didn't say that he might. He didn't say that he could. But he said that he will give life to mortal bodies. In the first part of that scripture, it says, "The Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you." It means that the power of God, the power that lifted Jesus on that bright sunny morning, that the power that raised Jesus from the dead is the same power that lives inside of you today. You see, Jesus didn't come to prove a point. He didn't come to put the devil in his place, which all of that happened. He didn't come just to die on a cross. Jesus came to give you power. He came to take you to a different level, to a new atmosphere. He came to give you something that those in the Old Testament did not have. When Jesus died on the cross, before he went and after he came, he told the disciples, he said, "Listen, don't leave Jerusalem until you receive the power that raised me from the dead. The power that lives in me is going to be inside of you." He came not only to die on the cross, but he came so your life would be better. He came so you could experience freedom. He came so you wouldn't have to worry about those dead areas of your life anymore. Because inside of you, you have the power to resurrect dead things in your life. You have the power to resurrect areas of your life that need to be resurrected. You have inside of you the power of Jesus living inside of you. You have the resurrection power that Jesus had on that fateful day. It's awesome. And that is why we need to celebrate Jesus, and more than a celebration. That's why that we need to give God all that we have and let him know that we appreciate what he did. Jesus deserves a celebration all by himself. God never intended today to be just a celebration. God intended for today to be the power of Easter inside of your body. Today we celebrate Easter's power to come into the dead areas of your life, so that your dead areas can come to life by the same Spirit that was living inside of Jesus. It's awesome. We all have dead areas. And the resurrection of Jesus gives us power to close the gap between the life that you're living and the life that you could live. The resurrection power is inside of us, but before he entered where he needed to be, he had to go through a process. How many of us know there's always a process to Jesus? All through the Bible, we read about processes. It would be easy for Jesus to have died on the cross and immediately rose back from the dead, wouldn't it? He could have done it. He could have, on the same moment he bowed his head and said, "It is finished," he could have raised it back up, changed his body into a glorious body, and he could have come back to life in an instant. Could he have not? But any time that we go through Jesus, we go through a process of Jesus. When the Israelites were going through, and we've talked about it before, they went from Egypt into the wilderness, into the promised land, but they couldn't go to the promised land until they got the Egypt out of them in the wilderness. There was a process that had to be done. You can't go from Egypt into the promised land, because if you do, you're bringing too much junk into a land that is filled with nothing but glory, filled with nothing but joy and happiness. So you've got to be able to go through that filter, that transition period, in order to get to where you need to go to. Every place that we go, it has to go through a process. When you go to a job interview, you go and fill out an application. You don't get hired immediately. They have to do a process. They have to go through a background check. They have to go through calling your people and seeing who you are and how and what you're about. They look on Facebook and see all your garbage and your junk. And they put all of that together, and that's the process that they go through. Anything that you go through takes a process. If you go to get a loan from a bank, you go through a process. It's not an immediate. They don't just give it to you. So every time in Jesus' word, there's processes all the way through the Bible. And today's no different with that process. Egypt was a place of bondage. Wilderness was a place of transformation. And Lord knows we know the promised land was a place filled with glory, a place that was filled with victory and blessings and newness. God shows us what can happen in our life. In 1 Peter 2:21, in the Message version, it says this: "This is the kind of life you've been invited to. The kind of life Christ lived. He suffered everything that came his way so you would know that it could be done, and also know how to do it, step by step." In 1 Peter 2:22 in the New Living, it says, "And he never sinned nor ever deceived anyone. He did not retaliate when he was insulted, nor did he threaten revenge when he suffered. He left his case in the hands of God, who always judges fairly. He personally carried our sins in his body on the cross so that we can be dead to sin and live for what is right. Because by his wounds, we are healed." Jesus gave us step-by-step instructions. In 1 Peter 2:21, it shows us something, and I've never really thought about it this way. I've always heard the saying, "It's Friday, but Sunday's coming." Okay, I'm going to be a little ignorant here, because I never really understood that until I really started studying what it means that Friday is here, but Sunday is coming. I want to tell you that this morning, sitting in this place, there are some of you that are sitting in your Friday. There are some of you that are sitting in your worst day that you've ever sat in before. There are some of you that are sitting in your worst battle that you've ever been through before. But I've come here to tell you this morning that your Sunday is coming. I've come here to tell you today that your Sunday, your victory, is on its way. Sunday, Friday may be here, but there is a Sunday that is coming. You may be sitting in your Saturday, and your Saturday is a place of confusion, and it's a place of not knowing what's going on. The Saturday represents God not doing nothing in your life. But I'm here to tell you this morning that your Sunday is on its way, that you're almost to your victory. You're almost to your place. That's what I want to talk to you about this morning. Those three things. Because the Bible teaches us that the process starts with a Friday and ends with a Sunday. There is a lesson in our spiritual journey, and it's Christ's death in his burial and his resurrection. And each day is significant. I don't know about you, but everything in the Bible has a significance. The rock has a significance. The water has a significance. Everything that is in this word, everything that God has placed in here, has a very significant purpose in this word. Not every, the these are significance, the ands are significance, the as and the as and all of those verbs and nouns and proverbs and all of that stuff that I studied and didn't know anything about, it's all significant in here. It's all relevant in this place, and you have a place in God's kingdom, and you are just as relevant today as they were in this book. You are just as relevant today to God that anyone else is. And everybody that is in here was just as relevant to God. It may have taken 80 years for Moses to be used, but Moses got used for his purpose. Noah may have sat around twiddling his thumb, but one day God came to him with a purpose, and he said, your purpose is to build a boat. Your purpose is to free people and help people. Your purpose is to save my people, because you are the only righteous one on the face of this earth. Everybody has a purpose. It doesn't matter where you've been, what you've done, where you've been to. It doesn't matter what your background is. It doesn't even matter where you are at today in your spiritual walk with God. If you don't have a spiritual walk with God, it makes no difference, because God still has a purpose for your life. You see, Friday came. I was reading a poem this morning, and it's actually a song, I believe, but I don't know, and I haven't sung it, but I just pulled it up, and it says, Friday's coming, or Sunday's coming. And it says, it's Friday, and Jesus is praying, Peter's sleeping, Judas is betraying, but Sunday's coming. It's Friday, but Pilate's struggling, the council is conspiring, the crowd is vilifying, and they don't even know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday, and the disciples are running like sheep without a shepherd. Mary's crying, Peter's denying, but they don't even know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday, and the Romans beat my Jesus. They robe him in a scarlet. They crown him with the crown of thorns, but they don't even know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday, and see Jesus walking to Calvary, his blood dripping, his body stumbling, and his spirit burdened. But you see, it's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday, and the world's winning. People are grinning, sinning, and evil is grinning. It's Friday, and the soldiers nail my Savior's hands to the cross. They nail my Savior's feet to the cross, and they raise him up next to criminals. It's Friday. But let me tell you something. Sunday's coming. It's Friday, and the disciples are questioning what happened to their king, and the Pharisees are celebrating that their scheming has been achieving, but they don't know it's only Friday and Sunday's coming. It's Friday, and he's hanging on the cross, feeling forsaken by his father, left alone, dying, can nobody save him. It's Friday, but Sunday's coming. It's Friday, and the earth trembles, and the sky grows, and my King yields his spirit. It's Friday, and hope is lost. Death is won. Sin is conquered, and Satan is just a laughing. It's Friday. Jesus is buried, and a soldier stands guard, and a rock rolled into its place. But it's Friday. It's only Friday, and Jesus is coming. You see, when we think about Friday, we have to think about what significance that has for us in our own life. You think about one day that Jesus had that was a bad day in Jesus' life. It was a rough day, I can imagine. And it started off in the Garden of Gethsemane, and it started off where he was praying to God, to his Father, and he was praying. He said, "Lord, whatever can happen." Jesus knew what was coming. He said, "Lord, I don't want to experience this pain, but God, it's not my will, it's your will." And then the guards came, and they took him away, and they shackled him, and they treated him like a common criminal, and took him to a place, and the Sanhedrin, and Peter denied him, and Judas had already run off and sold him out, and all of these things were happening, and it's only Friday, and it's a bad day. He gets crowned with a crown of thorns. He gets sold out to a crowd that was once hollering out. See, he had people turned their backs on him. People were talking about him. People were humiliating him and spitting on him. People were beating him down, and people were, he went through everything. My whole point is that everything that you've ever experienced in your life, Jesus has also experienced in his life. Jesus wanted to experience everything that you could possibly imagine could go wrong in your life, went wrong in his life. And some of you may say, well, Jesus was never married, so he don't know what it's like to go through a divorce. Can I tell you what the Bible says? The Bible says that the church is the bride, right? Does it not talk about us being married with Jesus? Can I tell you that he's experienced more adultery, more cheating on him than any of you have ever experienced in your life? Can I tell you he is wound up with people walking away from him and leaving him for no reason whatsoever? He is a God that has experienced everything that you can imagine. If you're single, he's experienced that temptation just like you've experienced that temptation. It's been flaunted in his face just like it gets flaunted in your face. He's been through it. He has seen it. He has done it. He has wrote the book on it, and he came through it. He is a victorious God, but Friday is only here. The misery that you're experiencing today, last week he went to the tomb of his best friend, and he stood at that tomb, and he had watched his best friend pass away. He had heard that his best friend was sick and sick to the point of death. But yet he went to that tomb and he resurrected him. And I believe that was a sign to the disciples that was saying, watch what I do to him, because what I do to him is the same thing that's going to happen to me. When you see this dead man raised from the grave, then you're going to see me raised from the grave. Don't fret. My worst day is going to be here, but the best day is on its way. I can tell you, you may be experiencing your worst day in your life. I haven't been through everything that you've been through. I couldn't imagine everything that you have faced. I couldn't do that. But there are some things in my life that I have experienced. I've gone through losing everything that I have, a house, a car. I've gone through losing my job. But more importantly, I went through losing my own self. I lost my respect, I lost my integrity, I lost who I was. I lost the definition of who Brad McVeigh was. I didn't know who I was, and I came to a place where I had to find my own self. But thank God that I had a Jesus that didn't judge me for who I was, that didn't care what I had been through. All he cared about it was where he wanted to take me to. I may have been down, I may have been out, I may have even been dead on the inside, but I found a God that had resurrected, and that same God that was resurrected is the same God that put his power in me, and my life was turned around in a moment and in an instant. God breathed life back into me, and he raised me back up from a dead state, and he gave me my life back. Where I wasn't nothing, he gave me something. Where I didn't have, he gave me. And I'm not talking about material possessions. I'm talking about a life that is more precious than any life that I've ever had before, that more than precious than my teenage years. It's a life that is more precious today and more valued today than I could ever have. Amen. On that Friday, he may have experienced pain, but he saw you in his face. He may have experienced hurt. He may have experienced turmoil. And can I tell you, he was a God that did not have to go through what he went through. Because it says in the Bible that he could have called 10,000 angels, a league of angels, at any moment, at any time. He could have been on the road, on the cross, carrying the cross down that dirty road, and he could have said, I'm done. Come on, angels, come get me. He could have quit at any time. He didn't have to suffer what he suffered. He didn't have to experience what he experienced. But he did it because he loves you and he cares about you and he wants you to grow. He wants to heal you. He wants to touch you. And he wants to resurrect your life. But I'm too far gone. No, you're not. Because if you've got breath inside your body, you are not too far gone. If God has left you here for right now where you are not too far gone. But I'm 70 years old. I had a grandfather who was 88 years old, and he accepted the Lord right before he died. You're not too old. There was two other criminals on the cross with Jesus. One accepted him at the last moment, at the last second. He accepted him. The other one continued to mock. And Jesus said, I'll see you in the promised land. It was a day of pain. Friday represents the day of pain. Friday represents the punishment at its worst. Friday represents the warring that we go through. He experienced physical pain, whipping, beating, crown of thorns. He experienced emotional pain. And the Bible says that he was despised and he was rejected. And he was a man of many sorrows. He was betrayed not only by the crowd, but he was betrayed by those that were even closest to him. He experienced relational pain, tempted on all points. If you read about his family, you read that his family was crazy in the head, just like all of our families may be at sometimes. I know sometimes we think about Jesus and think, oh, he must have had that holy family. Well, you need to read the scriptures, because the holy family didn't really accept Jesus for who he was. His brother said, there goes that crazy boy again. Somebody needs to do something, because he's out of his mind. They didn't really trust in Jesus and believe in Jesus, so they didn't really back Jesus the way everybody else did. They say that sometimes the hardest thing to do is to be able to win your own people to you. If I went back to my hometown, it'd probably be kind of difficult for people to believe that I had changed, because they only knew me as Drunk Brett. They didn't know me as Pastor Brett. So it'd probably be kind of difficult for them, and something new for them, to see me the way that I am. And see, a lot of them, Jesus grew up as the carpenter's son, or as the one that helped the daddy build things. They didn't really know him as Jesus, so to see him as he was different. But he had a crazy family too. He had a Friday moment. He had an Egypt kind of day. He felt the pain. But there's a lesson in the pain. See, in Romans 8:28, it says, And we know that God causes everything, all of your pain, everything that you're going through, God causes everything to work together for the good. God knows how to flip your pain and turn it into a victory. Of those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose for them. See, that's some of the benefits of being a child of God. Because it says, for those who love the Lord. Now, if you don't love the Lord and you've never accepted him as Jesus Christ, and you only come to church just because you want to make sure everybody knows, but you don't really have a relationship with God, God can't turn things that are going wrong in your life into good things. He only turns the things from bad to good for those that love him and are called according to his purpose. So I've got news for you today. In order for you to have the benefits, you got to join the club. You got to get into the relationship with Jesus Christ. I'm not telling you got to join the church and you got to be the best Christian. I'm telling you that you got to not only believe that he rose from the dead, but you got to act like Jesus rose from the dead, and you got to put him in your life and activate that power that's within you that can resurrect the dead, that can resurrect the dead areas of your life and bring back to purpose who you are. Yeah. God puts purpose in the pain. See, a lot of you have heard me talking about us moving here. And I know that this is the place where God wanted us to be. And there's a purpose to everything that God does. See, we made a point that we wasn't coming to Lenox, or we wasn't going anywhere, really. We were going to stay in our comfortable house and our nice in-ground pool, and we were going to live the life out. I'll get me a church that's close and won't have to go very far. Well, you shouldn't tell God your plans. Because when you tell God your plans, he's going to share with you his plans. And when they say there's a small little church out in a place called Lenox, and I'm thinking, where's Lenox? Is that close to Hinesville? Because I didn't know where that was either. And the guy said, if you go out there, it's a nice little church, got a great little parsonage. I want you to go out there and I want you to just... Try it out and see. Come out here, we have 9 people. And it's my first church. Thank Lord, you must have a sense of humor. Then Sister Brenda stands up and says, we can't pay you a dime. And out of my mouth, I heard myself say, it don't matter. And Sister Sherry heard it too. And she, when we got in the car, she said, you crazy. Because I was thinking it. And I was like, where did that come from? It don't matter. I got a job. I'm working, making good money. And you can't pay me. And I'm saying it don't matter. What's wrong with me? There's 9 people in the church. I can get $10 if that... But God says, trust me. Even on your Friday, even in your miserable, painful, hurtful, humiliating, awful day, even in a day that you don't understand why you're in that kind of day, even in a day that is just, it feels like the whole world is going to just suffocate you and kill you. It feels like you will never make it out of that day. That's the kind of day that I'm talking about. I don't know if you've ever been through that kind of day. I have. I don't know if you've ever experienced that kind of day, but I have. I've been through a day where I didn't want to live. I've been through the days where I didn't want to see people. I've been through the days where it felt like the whole world was going to just stomp on me and put me in the ground. It felt like there was no way I could be any different than I am today. It felt like that nobody believed in me. Nobody trusted me. Nobody loved me. Nobody cared about me. It seemed like the whole world had turned their backs on me, and I was not going to be who God wanted me to be. But I've got news for you. That's your Friday. Sunday's on its way. And see, after experiencing all that, and Jesus got on the cross, and he died on the cross, and he put his arms out, and he put his head down, and he said, he put his life and he put his spirit into God's hand, and he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head, and he took his last breath, and he died. And they carried him away, and they put him in the tomb. They rolled the stone away. They sealed the tomb up. Angels came and guarded the tomb, and Saturday came. And see, Saturday represents your day of confusion, where you don't know which way it's going. You're in the middle. You're in that transition period because you don't really know if it's going to get worse. You don't know if it's going to get better. And see, the disciples had taken off and they had went and locked themselves in a room because now they had followed Jesus all through these days and they had seen the miracles that he had performed, seen everything that he had done. They had gone through all of these things with him. They had seen him raise Lazarus up from the dead. And then they've come to a point of transition. They're locked in their room. Are they coming out after us? Are they going to kill us too? Are we going to be crucified too? Are they going to knock us down too? And some of us we're in that transition period. We don't know which way to go. We just have to have faith that God's word is what God's word says it is. And we're in that period where we don't know. Some of you are in that spot. You're in that day of confusion. Because you've experienced the Friday, you've gone through the hurt, and the hurt's kind of subsided, and now you're just locked yourself away, and you don't know what's coming next. You're in the Saturday. But I've got news for you. Sunday's coming. You see, Friday represents the misery, the day of pain, and Saturday represents the day of confusion. Oh, but Sunday. I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, "Sunday's coming." I want you to know that there is no pain that God's purpose cannot redeem. There is no pain that God's purpose cannot redeem. Saturday's coming. Saturday's here, and you're in a waiting room. Anybody ever been to the doctor? Lord have mercy, when I think of a waiting room, if there ain't no more pain than going to a doctor and sitting in a waiting room, that's just pain. Your appointment's at 2 o'clock and it's 3 o'clock right now and you still ain't been seen. And maybe they send you into a room, but you're still waiting. And what do? You get frustrated. Your blood pressure starts to rise. And you're sitting in that waiting room waiting for something to happen. And it just hasn't happened the way you wanted it to happen. You're sitting in that waiting room and you're expecting it to happen the way you want it to happen, and God says it's going to happen the way I want it to happen. You're sitting in that waiting room and you're waiting for the blessing to fall. You're waiting for the victory to come. You're waiting for that day of glory. See, there's a process, because Friday is the day of misery, but Saturday is the day of transformation. Saturday is where God's building your faith. Saturday is where God's growing you. Saturday is where you're coming. You're coming where God wants you to be. He's strengthening your belief. He's strengthening who you are. He's bringing you to the place where you need to be. He's got Sunday on the horizon, but he's forming you right now. We're in a spot. What do we want? We want answers. Why do I have to go through this? We begin to doubt. Thomas doubted so much that it eternally stuck to his name. And we give up. One disciple gave up and committed suicide. We feel alone. And we're stuck in the Saturdays of our life. We doubt everything. But remember, it was only Saturday. David said, "When I tried to understand all of this, it was oppressive to me." And the Message version says that it gave me a headache. It wasn't until I entered into the sanctuary of God, and then I understood. You may not get all the answers, but I know one thing you will get, and that is hope. You may not understand everything that's going on in your life. You may not understand why this has happened or why that has happened. You may not understand anything that is going on in your life right now, but I've got news for you this morning that I serve a God that has a purpose for every reason under the sun. There's something that God is trying to do in your life, that God is trying to bring you to a place of glory and a place of victory. God is trying to take you from the lowest place to the highest mountain. It's Saturday, but Sunday's coming. Jesus. How do I get to Jesus? How do I get to Sunday? How do I experience Sunday? Because Sunday is the day of resurrection. See, the Bible says, and we talked about the commandments, where it says, honor the Sabbath day. Keep the Sabbath day holy. And we talked about what that means. It means that God set aside a day that was a blessed day, that was a sanctified day, and it was a day that was filled with glory. It's not just keep the Sabbath day, remember the Sabbath day. It's remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. That means go to a place and get your blessings and get filled up with all that God wants to fill you up with. Get your glory on and get your praise on and worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Set aside that day to give God some praise. Amen. It's Sunday and it's Resurrection Day. It may be Friday, maybe Saturday, but hold on, because your Sunday is coming. You see, Jesus summed it up in one word. How do I experience winning? He summed it all up in one word. Are you ready? Jesus. How do I experience winning? Jesus. How do I experience glory? Jesus. How do I get better in my life? Jesus. How do I go through misery and pain? Jesus. Because even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil because He is with me. Jesus. It doesn't mean you won't ever experience anything ever again. It means that when you experience it, that it will be greater than you've ever. You can get in the valley and worship God. You can get in the dark places and celebrate. You can be locked up in a jail cell and you can give God glory. It doesn't matter what situation you wind yourself up in, that the day of winning will take you to a place of glory that'll make you celebrate no matter where you're at in your life, no matter what you're going through. A cop pulls you over on the interstate and you can give God praise for being able to be where you are today. Thank you, Jesus, for I'm getting a ticket. Hallelujah! Shouldn't have been breaking the law. Sunday. It's the promised land of the Old Testament. The promise fulfilled. It's a day when the dead things came to life. It's the day where confusion is past, and pain is a memory. Today, there's not any more pain. Today, there is no more confusion. And He who gives all of this, who is it that changes all of this for me? He can resurrect the dead areas of your life. And His name is Jesus. It's Easter. And He is the resurrection. And He is the life. John 11, 25 and 26 says, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me will live even though he may die. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Then he asked the question, do you believe this? There is no death that his power cannot resurrect. On Easter, we celebrate the resurrection spirit of Jesus Christ. We celebrate the spirit that has entered into our bodies, and we have the power to change our own lives. We have the power to resurrect and get out of our miserable, unhappy lives. We have the power to overcome. We have the power to overtake. We have the power to rise above and to go further. We have the resurrection power lifted inside of us. Nobody went to the tomb and raised him from the dead. He raised up from the dead. David said in the Bible, I had to encourage myself. I had to dig down deep within myself, and I had to give myself courage. I'm telling you this morning that there's some of you in here this morning that need to get a determination about you that says, I will no longer live the way I'm living. I'm going to rise. I'm going to go further. I'm going to resurrect those areas in my life that I didn't think I could do. If you set your mind to it, you can do whatever you set your mind to. If you are a child of God, you have the power inside of you to do what you put your mind to do. He put the resurrecting power inside of your life. He put the life inside of you. It's Easter. I'm going to close. But I want to tell you, you don't have to live in the pain anymore. I want to tell you, you don't have to live in the hurt anymore. You don't have to be nailed to that cross all the time, because your sins were forgiven. Will you stand for a moment? There was no greater miracle in the Bible than the miracle of Jesus rising from the dead. I don't have to sit by the roadside, blind, not able to see. I don't have to be locked up in my cave, bound and shackled in my grave clothes. I don't have to be down and out anymore. I don't have to be miserable anymore. It's your choice as to how you want to be in the future. It's your decision, because you have the power in you. He didn't say some of you have it. He said all of you have it. You've got a choice to make. It's Easter Sunday. God, I want all that I can have. God, I know I haven't been where I needed to be, but God, I want to experience winning. I'm tired of experiencing the losing and the misery. God, I'm tired of experiencing the hurt. God, I want to experience winning. For once in my life, I want to win. I want to be victorious. I want to be where you want me to be. God, I want to experience my purpose. God, resurrect those dead areas of my life and let me succeed in what you want me to succeed in. God, show me where I need to be. Is that you? I'm just going to ask you for a moment. If it is, I want you to just come on this Easter morning. We're not having service tonight. We're not going to be worshiping tonight. I want to take just a few moments this morning and ask you, God, resurrect. I'm in my Friday, but God, I know my Sunday's coming. God, I put my Friday in your hands. Is that you? Don't be afraid. Come. Is that you? Are you in your Fridays? Come. Thank you, Jesus. Sister Elaine, will you come for just a moment? Thank you, Jesus. Come on, are you in your Fridays? I know there's some of you that are in your Fridays that ain't making a step. I want you to come. I'm in my Friday, but I want to win. I don't want to be miserable. I want to be victorious. I don't want to experience the pain anymore. I don't want to experience the hurt. I want to put my life in Jesus' hands. I want to put my whole countenance in his hands. Well, maybe you're in your Saturday. Maybe you're just in that period. Maybe you're just in that wilderness right now. Maybe you're in your transformation. Maybe you want some confirmation. God, is my Sunday coming? But God, I'm believing in you. God, today, Father, resurrect the dead areas of my life. Today, God, put your hand upon me. God, today, God, you see everything that's in me. God, today, Father, I want to go further. I want to be lifted up. God, activate that power. God, give me your Easter power. Oh, God, guide me and direct me. God, change me right now, Father. Lord, in the blink of an eye, change me right now, Jesus. Lord, have your way. God, take me out of my Friday. Bring me to my Sunday. Father, I know I'm going to have to go through my Saturdays, but God, I know Sunday's coming. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we praise you, Jesus. Lord, we praise you, Jesus. Oh, Jesus, I know Sunday's on. Oh, it's coming. Sunday's coming. I'm not going to be like this. I'm not going to stay like this. God, I know that, God, you're going to lead me through the valley of the shadow of death. God, you're going to take me through the praise. God, you're going to take me through the tornadoes and the hurricanes and the storms. But, God, I'm walking with you. Oh, God, I know it's Friday. I know it's Saturday. But, God, I know that Sunday's on the way. A Sunday, a day of resurrection, a day of winning, a day of glory, a day of celebrating. God, I want to celebrate. God, today, Jesus. Lord, have your way, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, God, I'm not going to stay in my Friday. God, I want you to help me through this. God, I need you to help me through my Friday. God, bring me to my Sunday. Bring me to my victory. Bring me to the glory land, Father. Lord, bring me to the promise. Father, I know that there's a promise coming. God, I know that Easter's on its way. God, I know that Sunday and the resurrection. Father, I ask you, Lord, God, resurrect areas of my life that, God, I don't even know about. God, resurrect areas of my life that God is going to make a change in everything. Father, right now, Jesus, Lord, have your way. God, I praise you. God, I thank you, Jesus. Lord, have your way, Jesus. Will you lift your hands up for just a moment? Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I praise you for my Sunday. God, I praise you for my winning day. God, I praise you for your glory. God, I praise you for where you've brought me to. God, help me to help somebody else. God, don't let me go through this Easter Sunday, through this resurrection, without knowing that, God, I have the power that I can go out and help somebody else. That I can touch somebody else's life. Father, I praise you this Sunday. God, it's not just a celebration. God, you deserve my praise. Because God, you took stuff that I could never imagine taking. Father, you did stuff that I could never imagine doing. Father, for that I give you praise. God, I celebrate you today. God, I give you glory. Father, for all that you've done and all that you're going to do. In Jesus' name. Video. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You want to know what the passing power looks like? He says, look at Jesus. Jesus was crucified. Jesus was nailed to the cross. But Friday didn't determine where things wound up. Look, Friday was a bad day for Jesus, all right? It was a bad day physically. He was beaten to a pulp. It was a bad day emotionally. He cried tears like blood in the Garden of Gethsemane. It was a really bad day spiritually. He was separated from his Father. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? He lost his friends. He lost his life. Body beaten to a pulp, separated from his Father. I call Friday a bad day. But Friday wasn't the last day. It was a bad day. Because according to the verse, it says, the surpassing greatness of his power when he raised Jesus up from the dead. In other words, God reversed the day. Now, I know some of you came here beaten and broken. Some of you came in emotionally beaten, physically beaten, attitudinally beaten, spiritually beaten, relationally beaten. You've come broke down, beat up, toe up from the flow up. Circumstances have not been in your favor. But Paul says, I want you to know the surpassing greatness of his power. And it's the same power that was working when he raised Jesus Christ up from the dead, or turned death into life, bad into good, worse into better. He flipped the script and turned things around. And he ties it to the person of Jesus Christ. See, what the cross provides you and me is the opportunity to see what God can do out of the normal, out of the regular, out of the everyday-ish of life, and how he can invade the circumstances of life just like he invaded the tomb of Jesus when he died on the cross and flipped things around, turned them, twist them, tweak them. See, a lot of us sing about his power, talk about his power, amen his power, but we can't testify to his power because we've never seen him flip, turn, twist, tweak something so that he did something that was beyond human comprehension. But he says, that's in your will. It's in your will. His superimposing power.
Today we have a hope. We have a hope of Jesus Christ. Today we have a hope that I don't have to be who everybody else wants me to be. I just have to be how he wants me to be. Today we have a hope. Friday may come. It may be a bad day, but it's like he said, it ain't the last day. Sunday's coming. Sunday's coming. It may not look good today, but wait, Sunday's coming. Yeah. Yeah. Father, I thank you, Jesus. Lord, I thank you for this great day. God, I thank you for the glorious day that you've given to us. God, I thank you for what you did on the cross. God, I thank you for what you did from the tomb. God, I thank you for what you did. God, I thank you for where you've brought us to. God, I ask you, Lord, that God, you will change lives this morning, that God, you will change hearts this morning, that God, this morning, that somebody's life was touched because of your work, because of what you did on the cross, that somebody has a change of life. And God, I thank you. And God, I give you praise and glory for all that you've done in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Will you give God a hand clap of praise? Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is good. And all the time. Amen. I want to say thank you to each and every